I'm very pleased to introduce today's speaker, a longtime friend and colleague from Mexico. Mauricio Hernandez trained in medicine and pathology in Mexico, and then went to the Harvard School of Public Health, where he earned his doctorate in public health, working in cancer epidemiology. He's since been honored by that institution with its Alumni Award of Merit, something that very few people receive each year in recognition of his contributions to public health and investigation in Mexico. Mauricio spent much of his career at the National Institute for Public Health in Cuernavaca. There he was director of the Centro de Investigaciones de Salud Poblacional, Center for Investigation in Population Health, then director of the institute, and while he was director, he led the accreditation of the institution by the Association of Schools for Public Health, ASPH, I think the first institution outside of the United States to be so accredited. While there, he was an accomplished educator. He has a book, introductory book on epidemiology available in Spanish, not yet translated into English, but it should be. It's an excellent text. He has carried out investigations on a wide variety of public health issues, the neurotoxicity of lead in children, air pollution, cancer, and public health application and policy, ways to screen for cervical cancer in less resourced rural environments. He moved on with the new administration in Mexico to become the Deputy Minister of Health. Maybe his good luck or bad luck, depending on your point of view, is that Mauricio was at the point in the recent outbreak of H1N1 in Mexico. I suppose every epidemiologist's dream, perhaps, is to be involved in an epidemic of sweeping proportions and of uncertain cause. Every epidemiologist, and probably every epidemiologist in a very public role, nightmare is probably to be in that position. But Mauricio and Mexico have stood up well in the work that they did. This was only one of the many challenges that Mauricio has faced in the now roughly 2+ years that he has been in this important position. He's dealt with tobacco control in Mexico, helping to facilitate the passage of a law effective nationally. He has the obesity problem on his plate, with 70% of Mexican adults now being overweight or obese. He'll be addressing this topic tomorrow in a talk at 5:15 at the School of Medicine in Oresti Auditorium in the Cancer Center. So I'd encourage those of you who want to hear about another epidemic that he is addressing, go to that talk, an epidemic on a different time frame, but one that is going to be quite devastating. So today you'll have the opportunity to hear from someone who has made contributions as an academic, as a public health leader, and now someone who's really on the front lines in addressing the health needs of Mexico. Just one very mundane thing before I turn to Mauricio. Those of you who are USC medical students need to sign in with Dr. Sanchez, wherever he is hiding out in the back. So do sign in with Alex. So Mauricio, thank you for coming, and we look forward to your presentation on H1N1.
Thank you very much, John, for the nice introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here with you. And yes, eventually my dream came a nightmare for me in this position with this epidemic. It has been the most, I would say, busiest days of my life. And my son, my middle son, at the middle of the outbreak, sent me a picture with his cell phone. And the picture was the refrigerator was wide open, and it was totally empty. And he said, "That you it's good you don't come home, but send us some money." You know? So it was it was a comic relief. But planning to share with you today is give you a little bit of detail of how the epidemic was detected, what were we doing, how we came into these little details of the surveillance, then give you information where we are in the epidemic, which is not different at all of what you're seeing here in LA or what you hear in the US, but it's good you know the data. And third, I will go into what we have learned, what we learn, what we achieve with this epidemic. As they say, this crisis should help us to grow up and should help us to mature our systems and to get some benefits out of them. So this is more or less a chronological things of what it happened. This goes to what we have identified as the day number one, which came with a very unusual report from a case in Oaxaca. I received a telephone call from the Minister of Health of Oaxaca saying, "Mauricio, I have a SARS case and we are really worried, what do we do?" So I said, "Well, you know, it's very unlikely you have a case of SARS, but send us the samples." And we isolated the patients, we treat very intensively the case. Then at the same time, what we were addressing at that time, just to give you an idea of how busy we are every day, 60 days before the events, now I'm bringing you 60 days back, we were addressing a dengue epidemic that took place in the state of Morelos. That's a state where I live, and we had one of the major outbreaks of the country. We had every year 60,000 cases, 30,000 cases occurring in the state of Morelos. We were also working with CDC, an outbreak of rickettsias in Mexicali, your neighbor state down here in Baja. And we were also working with the states of the north of Mexico with an epidemic of pertussis, or whooping cough. And we were receiving at that time some signals from our system that there were an activity related to influenza, and mostly coming from Veracruz. And I'm going to mention this case in La Gloria Perote, because this community became very famous because it's very near a farm production, industrial farm production of pigs. And by lucky or unlucky, one of the samples that tested positive came from this community. So all the world pointed to that community as the origin of the swine epidemic, which is completely mistaken. There's even a paper by Ferguson in the Science that claims that the epidemic started there, but we know it's completely untrue. We were on that, and this slide I'm going to show you often this day. This is a very old epidemiological tool that helps us to detect when the disease frequency reaches levels of alert. And this is the graphical representation of the historical data that we have in Mexico, and this is for upper respiratory disease. So when disease goes over the red line, it means that it's surpassing the highest historical records that we have. When it's below the green line, we say, well, they are under-reporting. So we were constructing our channels, and this is what we were seeing in influenza, and we were monitoring, and then we have this point here that was coming
late in the year, late in the winter season, strange for Mexico, was coming out of the emergency line, and that triggered very much also our attention. If we see it more clearly with what we were seeing the year before, it's clear that in the red line you can see that there was a peak that came as we usually see in the winter season, but then there was a new peak that was, we interpreted that as a reactivation of the influenza season. This is when actually your president, elected President Obama, was visiting Mexico at this time. So. And well, coming back to the timeline, so we have these influenza cases in Perote. This is, was a very atypical epidemic because Perote is a small community in Veracruz, and almost 80% of the population works in the in the pig farm. So the state of Veracruz reported this case, this outbreak, to move over 618 cases. So it was something that attracted our attention, and we tested these cases. And most of the cases were seasonal influenza, and 1% was parainfluenza. This is tested by the Mexican laboratories and also by CDC, because in the surveillance that WHO has, CDC is our reference laboratory. So we send samples also very frequent to CDC, so the diagnosis is well collaborated. So coming back to case number one, which was, as you remember, reported by Oaxaca as SARS. That case was later sent to CDC and actually was confirmed as H1N1, and that's what we consider the index case. At that time, obviously, we didn't know. We have a case that was labeled as influenza, and it was an influenza that we could not subtypify in our laboratory, and we were having problems to say what type of influenza was with it. So after I had a report of this case, I had two other informal reports. I say they are informal because they arrive earlier in time, because the hospital statistics, they come to my office, but they come with a two-month delay. So these are informal. So I received a call from an infectious disease specialist in the state of San Luis Potosí, who claimed he was very worried because he was seeing a severe form of pneumonia which was affecting young adults, and he has never seen that before. At the same time, the director of the National Institute of Respiratory Disease in Mexico was also having a large number of cases with this type of disease. So we decided, with the case in Oaxaca and this, to convey our national surveillance committee to discuss the information at hand. So, day number three, we call this committee, and what this committee decides says, well, this is an intensification of the seasonal influenza. So, we launch a national alert. That means that every epidemiologist in the country gets an email, a letter, or a notification that says we are on alert and look for atypical cases of pneumonia. At the same time, we receive from the U.S. An advanced notification that here in California there have been an isolation of a new virus. However, the clinical picture associated with this virus here in the U.S. was very different from what we were seeing, because here was a very mild disease. It was discovered only by chance, because the physician who was seeing this kid pursuing the identification, and it came out to us as this. So we did not make the link at that time because there were very different pictures. Then, day number five, we decide to do what is called in epidemiology active surveillance. This means that we put in place an investigation that is not routinary. That means that it's a new procedure that we put in place to collect some extra data. And we went to visit the hospitals in Mexico City to see if the pattern of disease that was reported in the Institute of Respiratory Disease, which is a reference center for whole Mexico, was similar to what we were seeing in a common hospital in Mexico. And well, what we found was very alarming, because we found that if indeed all the hospitals were having an increase in the hospitalization rate. And what was very dramatic is that most of the people that were hospitalized with pneumonia were young people. Usually what we see, and you see later in graphs, we see that people with pneumonia are below 5 years old or above 65. So it was completely unexpected. A retrospective assessment of this also revealed that there have been some deaths associated to this disease, which have not been reported. So what our laboratory was telling us was, say, this is influenza. However, for some reason, we cannot identify what subtype of influenza is. So we request help from CDC and Canada, which are our partners in surveillance, and we also have a strong relationship because we've been prepared together for a pandemic. So we send the laboratories. They arrive first in Canada, because Canada has a little bit less restrictions than CDC, but we send the samples to both laboratories.
So the patients of this event and those from Oaxaca were sent to the National Laboratory of Microbiology and CDC on Tuesday.
Why we didn't do it before? Because there are regulations for import and export in samples, but still it's just a couple of days. So day nine, we made the official notification also to the international community through the international sanitary regulatory system. And in day 10, we got the confirmation. Canada informs that there are positive results, and they are positive to the new H1N1 virus, same as confirmed in CDC Atlanta. So same samples, two different laboratories, same result. So that really triggered a lot of alarm in Mexico. The Minister of Health convened for a meeting with experts, with the experts in Mexico City. We had participation also electronically from Canada and CDC. And the recommendation for the Minister of Health was to start with the pandemic plan and to communicate to WHO the findings, and that's what we did. And that was in 10 days, but everything happens, and I think this is a record time. If we think about SARS took at least 110 or 20 days before the world knew that there was an outbreak. So in that case, I think Mexico was very transparent and very early notified. So this is what I was telling you, and this is what we were seeing. This is the age distribution, the normal age distribution of hospitalized cases with severe pneumonia. And what we were seeing in Mexico is this. No, this is what we usually see. As you can see, the young ages are not affected. What we were seeing was a very high proportion of people of being hospitalized with young people hospitalized with pneumonia, which is completely different. This is what we see for the number of deaths. As you can see, also it was seen more in the younger ages, and that's what really triggered these very intense actions that the Mexican government put in place with social distancing, closing schools, diminishing business, churches, everything that what we did. Basically because we were facing a new pathogen. We knew we did not have immunity to this pathogen, and what we were seeing was that this pathogen was affecting young adults. So it was a very on Sorry. This is now, say, this is the official statistics. This is what now we have, now that all the death certificates have come to official notification. This is the age group 20 to 44 years of age. And in the different colors, blue, light blue, and green, you see the previous years, what we were seeing normally in the system. And in red, you see what we saw in the first wave of the epidemic. And clearly, there is an excess number of deaths in this young adult population. And that's what worries everybody, because it's a very different pattern of what we used to see. Now, let me shift to what we are seeing now. Again, this is our tool to understand what is happening. The red line reflects the maximum historical values in the last 10 years. And you can see here is the first peak of the epidemic. And then there is a second peak. This is epidemiological week. So this is January, and this is December, and they're graphed by week, the number of cases. So we have a major peak of respiratory disease. Then we have a second peak. This is what occurred later on in the Yucatan Peninsula, in Mérida, Cancun, Chiapas, and all the place of Quintana Roo. That's why I've been arguing that the spring breakers were not, well, they were infected in Mexico, but not for Mexicans. They were infected by spring breakers who were carrying the infection. But that's a fight that we have with CDC that other day we can go. But where are we now? We are in the country, in average, we are moving way up. Now, what we see is a little bit like a phenomenon of a popcorn. No? There are a city who starts with an epidemic here and there, but in average, this is what you see. This is the map of the country. This is March, so we have almost no municipality affected. And then as time goes by, you'll see that the country starts coloring up, because the virus is circulating everywhere and affecting a number of people. Luckily, I mean, most of the people who are infected, they have a self-limited flu-like illness, and there is no problems. This is the last one in October. So now you can see that all the well. How many cases do we have? This is an old slide. We have now 47,000 confirmed cases. That's not the total of cases that we have. That's the total of cases that arrive to the laboratory and are being confirmed. And so this is not, say, the number of cases that Mexico has. This is a complete, say, sample, small sample of the cases, which now are probably several millions. Now, this is how the epidemic curve looks. Here there is something that has been puzzling us, that is, if you see this in the red bar, we have the mortality, no? And it goes two waves of mortalities. This is the one of southeast, and then there's a small peak here, which is rising. This is up to this scale, up to 15. And then you have all the other lines, which are referred to this scale, which is more on the side of the several hundreds. So in the gray line, you see the cases which have an illness like influenza. And from these cases, the blue line reflects the percentage of cases that have been actually confirmed by PCR that they are influenza. So you can see there is a small part of them. It's increasing the positivity. Now we are confirming mostly all the cases. But what is very interesting is the other virus. For example, the other spectrum of disease is completely displaced by H1N1. So this is good news, because we are not going to have H1N1 on top of the seasonal virus. Seems that the seasonal virus have been displaced. We don't know if that's going to be the pattern for the whole winter, but those are very good news. This is how the data look without delay, because this is the number of cases reported per week and has almost no delay. So we have the first peak in the spring, the second peak in the southeast, and then we are again back to increasing. Here, we don't know if this is a peak that we are going to see increasing all over the winter, or we are going to see a decay, and that's what has, at this point in time, is worrying us very much, because if this peak continues increasing, we are going to see a saturation of the medical services. So, and this is how are we doing with the confirmation. Again, these data are preliminary because they have a delay by the time the people get the sample gets to the lab processes the sample gets back to the result to the system. So this is like 2 weeks delay. So I would say that this is where we stand here. We still don't know if this drop is correct. So, but this is very helpful because what we see is that most of the cases we are looking in the emergency room are H1N1, and we can treat with no need of making tests. And we, one of the good things of this epidemic is that we have antivirals which are available. Now, this is a complex graph, but it's easy to understand. It's expressed in 100%. So in the beginning of the year, we have different pathogens circulating. You see, we have syncytial virus, seasonal virus, parainfluenza, adenovirus, different viruses. And this is usually what you see in the winter period, that you have many viruses circulating. That's why even you get your flu shot, you still may get the flu because it's a virus which is not covered by the flu shot. So, but what happens is with the entrance of H1N1, what we see is a complete displacement. All the other viruses are absent. You know? So most of the cases that we are seeing, there's no doubt, are H1N1. So this is what I was saying, good news, because we don't have an additive epidemic, but we just have H1N1. And we are treating them early, so to avoid complications. Now, as you see here, H1N1 is a disease of young people. You see here that the highest prevalence or the highest attack rate is of people to 10 to 19 years old. There's no difference by gender, by sex, they're equally. And our hospitalization rate is a little bit older than what we were hearing today from the Los Angeles County Health Department, that here the hospitalization rate is younger. They were giving us a mean age of 12. Our mean age is around 20, 25. Now, this is what I've been telling you, that is worrisome, that the high mortality rate is between 20 and 49 years of age. And if you see the distribution proportionally, cases are much more represented in this age group. Our mortality in the younger ages is actually small compared with the other one, and is similar to what you see with influenza. We have now in place a system that tells how are the states doing in terms of the activity. So here you see the graphs that get produced every week. This is week 41. These are two main providers, the government health insurance, and this is the insurance for everybody who has a formal work. And what we are monitoring is the change every week, if the increase in hospitalizations change. And what we do is we help the states that have an increase with federal funds, or even with physicians when they don't have enough specialists to be able to treat the disease.
This is the prediction that our models are doing. It's a very day-to-day modeling, it's not very complicated. But if you see the peak that they are predicting is not good news for the winter season if this continues to grow.
And that's what is a lot of concern for all of us. So in the short term, we estimate that we could have almost 300,000 cases with 9,000 hospitalizations and almost 2,900 deaths, which for our health system is a big, big pressure. Now, just to give you a picture of what is happening around the country, just some examples. This is Mexico City, first peak, second peak, and now he's going. They're going into the winter peak.
This is Durango, a state in the north of Mexico. It's also going to the epidemic peak. This is Hidalgo. In Hidalgo, we just had a huge epidemic. It's almost as intense as the first one. This is Jalisco, Guadalajara. And then we have states that are going downwards. For example, this is Baja Sur, Los Cabos. If you're going for Christmas, Los Cabos is good. So, from now, Sinaloa, that's Mazatlán. If you're going to go surfing, also good news. Guanajuato and Michoacán, they're going
down. And then we have other states where nothing is happening, and they already suffered the epidemic.
This is Campeche, which is in the south of Mexico. This is Chiapas, which is in the south of Mexico. Two big peaks in Chiapas after the spring peak. Guerrero, Acapulco, and Quintana Roo, this is Cancun. And that's what I argue, that if we had had the epidemic in Cancun, we would have a peak right here, no? just before the spring break, and we don't have any activity before the spring. So the lesson here is that the different states are going at different levels, and we are working with them to help them in the way as it goes. Other big impact for Mexico was the loss in tourism, which is estimated at 0.3 of our gross national product. It's a huge, huge impact. If you imagine that a year of diabetes cost us 0.2%, it's a huge, huge impact to the system. So that was not good. Well, what we learned? Well, we did what was in our program. We had an active system that allowed for detection. Then we did containment measures with accurate and timely information to the international community, and a very extensive communication campaign to the general public in Mexico. We released our strategic reserve for safety materials and for the hospitals, as well as antivirals. We implemented the guidelines for triage and application of these non-pharmacological interventions in the affected areas, where we closed schools, we suspended public gatherings, and we recommended the isolation of cases, of suspected cases. After May 11, we have followed the recommendations of WHO, which is you cannot contain, the epidemic is here, is with us to stay, so let's mitigate the damage and let's try to save as much and to decrease the risk of mortality. So we strengthened our surveillance, we put in place a virology laboratory network all around the country, and we are continuing, but very in a very focalized way, applicating the non-pharmacological measures. So, in terms of lessons, preparedness really, really pays off. And I must tell you here that when I had to authorize a lot of my colleagues to travel to different places in the world to get prepared, to discuss, to build a pandemic plan, I was saying, well, you know, we're investing all this money and this never is going to happen. But luckily, we do it. We have a pandemic plan.
And that was very helpful, because when the Minister of Transportation called and said, well, what do I have to do? We tell, well, you have your plan. There's your plan, and follow your plan. And everybody knew what to do. And that helped very much to have an intersectorial talk and collaborations. We had a reserve. We invested in antivirals. So the announcement that we had an epidemic, but that we have 1 million treatments in stock and that the virus was susceptible to this treatment gave the population a lot of confidence. So the panic went down. We had a risk communication campaign already done with messages, with proof with the population. So we just had to change pandemic for influenza, and we had a campaign already in place. We would have liked it that our programs were on more detail, because the program would say, well, you will have to set a surveillance network. Well, never said how to set the surveillance, who will be in charge of the surveillance. And so that level of detail was not really done. And then we learned to have to be flexible to new situations. We never imagined that the pandemic was going to start in Mexico. No? We always put our system to build a shield of Mexico from a virus that was coming from Far East because we were waiting for H5N1. So that had to change dramatically. And I can give you an anecdote, because the guy of transportation calls me and says, Dr. Hernandez, we are ready. We are going to screen all the passengers that are coming to Mexico. And I said, wrong. You have to inform the page that the people who are going out of Mexico that we have the problem. No. We don't want to screen. We want to tell our travelers that if they get sick in their countries, they have to go immediately to the doctor. And that's what we did. We did a flyer, and everybody who went out from the international airports in Mexico got a flyer saying, we have an influenza outbreak. If you have disease, you must go to your physician. But those things were troublesome. And one which was very difficult to deal was the elections. We were about to go into elections, and as you know, these are used by the opposition saying, oh no, the Mexican government is now wanting to make us believe that we have a pandemic because they want to win the elections. And well, that was false, and we did really bad in the elections, by the way. So in terms of the disease, well, we learned that most people that get sick, they get the disease without complications, but this might overcharge the systems, and I'm going to give you an example. Only a very small proportion requires hospitalization. Deaths were mainly among young adults. What is troublesome is that 12 to 54%, depending on the city, they don't have any comorbidity. They were very healthy adults, and we don't have a way to explain. Other factors that we have identified: pregnancy, morbid obesity, asthma, another respiratory disease, diabetes, and AIDS. This is what happens in a small hospital, and I'll show you just the data really rapid. This is Comitán, a small hospital in the highlands of Chiapas. This is in what they normally see in the blue line, 50, 40 cases every week. And look with the epidemic, they went up to see 244 cases. So what happens here is the hospital collapse. There are so many people seeking attention. Then the people arrive to the same place where the healthy people are, and then you have a pregnant woman who goes for a consultation for pregnancy, then she gets influenza because she's mixed up. So we had to work really hard with the hospital so they can set their triage, and to separate patients that will go to the place. And this is at the end in the state what we saw. You see, this is the hospitalizations in the state. This is what we see in 2008. In people under 5 years old, we have in 2008 103. In 2009, during the epidemic, 85.
But look at this figure. In the young adults, 50 to 64, we have 438 compared to 88. So this really brings a lot of people to the hospital. 438 might not sound like a big number, but if you work in an emergency room and you are or in an intensive care unit, and you are used to have 2 patients a week, and suddenly you have 12 patients a week, then you are completely distressed. The hospital cannot cope with that. And that's why we are now helping the hospitals by sending physicians to help them. So we know lethality is low, and we want to maintain it below 1%. We have to protect vulnerable groups, and we are sending messages to pregnant women and people with chronic disease. We have to work with the specialized medical care for severe cases. And first level medical care, we are there. We had a disagreement with WHO. Sorry. This is not an advertisement for Starbucks. It's just that John Salmon has wake me up at 7 in the morning, and so I need to get something to boost myself. So. Well, we had an initial disagreement with WHO because we were pushing for early treatment. And every case that was coming to the units, we were giving treatment because we know that it's H1N1 which is circulating. Just 2 days ago, there was a meeting of experts at WHO convened, and they are urging now countries to treat people early in the disease because that's the only way to avoid complications. We have strengthened our surveillance system. Before the epidemic, we just had one central laboratory with capabilities of doing molecular diagnosis. Now we have a lab in every state. This is how the disease is portrayed, that you have many, many cases in the base, but they're all climbing up to be severe cases if you don't treat them well. And this creates the biggest pressure in the media, the biggest pressure in society, because people go to a hospital and they cannot get a bed, or they cannot go into an intensive care unit. And that's what we need really to attend and to avoid. And that's why we continue integrating our measurements with personal environment and personal hygiene, social distancing. We are pressing a lot for home and school filters. If you're sick, stay at home. If your kid is sick, please keep it home. This is what we know now about severity. This is the H5N1 that I was talking about, that we thought was at the beginning, which has a very high severity of disease, low transmissibility. This is the famous 1918 Spanish pandemic. And this is where influenza H1N1 sits with seasonal. So this means that we can do it. We strengthen the medical system. We can do it with the public health measures that we are doing. Now, communication. This was one of the biggest challenges. How you will communicate the population that you have a new disease. Well, we took care of all stakeholders, all the people who felt they were at risk, were at risk. We based our communication on scientific issues, and we tried to be transparent, and we had a lot of questions. Is the virus mutating? Is it this? Well, the answer was, I don't know. We don't know. There's no evidence. This is a new disease. So we tried to come very open front and this. And we evaluated what people were thinking. We did some surveys, and I showed you some things. Risk perception is very, very complex. We learned that it gets influenced from many places. So we were, Mexico was in the top of the epidemic, and WHO was declaring phase 5, phase 4, but we were already in phase 5 at the beginning because we were already doing our measures. So we never were able to communicate well why WHO was doing measure 5 and we were not really attending the measures of WHO, because we had already done them. You know? So and that created and really shows that now we live in a very global environment. So news from all the place come here.
spokesman is very important, and in this case, I think Minister Cordova, my boss, was chosen as the spokesman, and he did a very good, very good job communicating and speaking to the public. He appeared three or four times a day during the peak times in the media. Our phone, our 1-800 line over the epidemic received 5 million telephone calls. So that has never seen in any show, in any anything. There was a record for Mexico, 5 million phone calls. The risk communication that we, the challenge that we have now is, well, there is still a lot of speculation about the virus. The people are always asking, is it going to mutate? Are we going to get a more aggressive virus? Am I at risk of death? Is this a catastrophe? Second is vaccines. And believe me, this is a great challenge because US is vaccinating, Canada is vaccinating, France is vaccinating. So they say, the Mexican public say, well, and we, are we not going to get our vaccine? So first, how to explain that the vaccines are not available? Second, who will get the vaccine, because there will be a shortage. That has been a nightmare. This is a little bit of the surveys we were doing during the epidemic. This asked the public, how concerned are you about getting influenza? And it dropped down from 62 to 45%. Not very much, if you see. Even though we were communicating, people were still at risk of getting influenza. This is if the government has enough capacity to attend influenza. This is worrisome because even though we never got an overflow of beds in the hospitals, the people had a perception that we did not have enough beds to cope with the epidemic. So that was one of the jobs that we did not do well in terms of communication about them. Well, just to close up, let me tell you some things. This is our icon for prevention. It's called PROMI, and it has all the different activities. When we distribute, we have one which is dressed as a soccer football player. We have one which is dressed like a kid. It has no gender to be also appropriate in terms of communication. So what are our objectives now? Well, we're building capacity. We are doing courses for general practitioners to have adequate prescription. We are extending our stocks of medicine and supplies and equipment for hospitals. We did just a purchase of 1,000 respirators to supply all the intensive care units. We make all the states to do their mitigation plan, and also every hospital has their mitigation plan, which includes how they're going to do their triage, and we also have strengthened our surveillance. We have our vaccination strategy, although we have a contract that we have with Sanofi Pasteur, and we purchase our vaccine. This vaccine cannot be supplied because different countries have an embargo in the production, and they're not going to release doses for exporting until the local markets are fulfilled with vaccine, which is troublesome for the countries that don't have a plan. So we establish our definition. I'm going to move to this one. This is the target population that we are going to be vaccinating when we have the vaccine. First is going to be the health personnel, because we want to keep the health system very healthy, avoid absenteeism. Second, or at the same time, pregnant women, because we've seen in Mexico that there is an excess death among pregnant women. Second, children between 6 and 24 months of age. And then population 2 to 64 with risk factors. These are more or less 30 million Mexicans, and that's what we are hoping to get. We are posing the idea among the Mexican public that vaccination is only one of the various things that we can do to prevent the disease. We are not really stressing that vaccine might be the solution, first because we don't know when we will get the vaccines, and second because it's very likely that this vaccine will arrive late December, when our epidemic peak is maybe gone or even at a higher stage. So we are trying to downplay the importance of vaccine. This morning that I met with the health commissioner in Los Angeles, he misinterpreted my comment that I was saying that the vaccine is not important. Well, the vaccine is important, but depends how many people you vaccinate and when and which time of the epidemic peak you give the vaccine. All the models tell us that as farther away you give the vaccine in the peak, less efficient it is, because there's less people to protect. And you cannot vaccinate only people who are not immune, because you cannot tell who is immune and who is not immune. So this is the discussion that we had. And we are fighting with the U.S., so they released the at least 5 million doses to Mexico that we need to start, and we are in that little battle for doses, as we hear here that even in L.A. they have a shortage of vaccines. So I really thank you again for the invitation. I tried to do it really fast, so to get some time for comments and questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.